Recently I began working on prototyping mechanisms for the CMC joint, which would live in the carpal section of the hand. But I quickly realised that I still had a lot of questions about the wrist, and it became clear that I would need a solid idea of the kind of mechanism I would be using for the wrist, so that I can come up with a more solid, integrated solution to the CMC joint's wrist, and also the carpal section as a whole. In this video, I want to give a very brief overview of the anatomy of the wrist and look at how wrists move in real hands. I also want to talk about wrist solutions in other bionic hands and try to work towards how I want the wrist to function in my own hand. Do note that for this video, I'm only really going to look at the proximal joints of the wrist, which includes the flexion slash extension and lateral deviation of the hand, as opposed to the distal joint of the wrist, which actually has a motion that results from movements in the bones of the forearm. I'm making an assumption, at least for this video, that the turning over of the palm motion in a mechanical prototype would be driven from somewhere near the base of the forearm, like in a real hand where the motion actually comes in part from your bicep muscle. So what I'm primarily concerned with in this video is the mechanism at the actual physical location of the wrist in the arm, which is responsible for movements this way and movements that way. So looking at my initial wrist design first of all, I think it is probably quite clear that this mechanism was sort of a quick fix. Over the course of the two semesters that I worked on this project, I had a lot to get through, and I think that maybe some of the design from the wrist down sort of took a back seat really in comparison to the fingers, palm and thumb. The mechanism is simply two hinge joints with a common axis, which is a totally valid solution, but since I used these really big MG996R servos and tried to cram them into the joint itself, it ended up working pretty poorly and looking quite bad too. So the wrist, although it looks like it could be a really simple ball socket joint, is actually far more complex. In the carpal section of the hand, which is the big cluster of bones under the metacarpals, there are 8 little bone nuggets which are all involved in the motion of the wrist. These carpal bones move around on the radius and ulna bones of the forearm, which together form quite a complex joint surface. It was tricky to find any scans or animations that show how exactly the carpal bones move, and in this example from the Medical University Vienna, I should mention that there are some errors and artifacts, but you should get an impression of just how complex the kinematics are. Supposedly, there are 42 degrees of freedom between all of the carpal bones. When it comes to designing a simplified mechanical model of the wrist, the issue comes from the fact that the wrist is actually a mobile system of joints able to adapt its form depending on the forces applied to it, rather than being something we can really find a static or even moving centre of rotation for. So I think that trying to directly replicate this structure or its movements mechanically would be very inefficient for a project like mine. Maybe if you took the HBARH approach and replicated the, quite frankly, nightmare of ligaments, joint capsules and tendons in the wrist, you could have a truly biomimetic design. And I hope it doesn't sound like I'm disparaging that idea. It would absolutely be incredible to see, and I'd love to work on something like that one day. But for my requirements, it would obviously be a very good idea to find a simplified mechanical model of this motion. So if you remember in the metacarpal motor video, I mentioned that the MCP joints of the fingers are condyloid joints, which is kind of like an elongated ball socket joint. According to Schmidt and Prommersberger, we can actually regard the wrist as a modified condyloid joint, wherein the ball section of the elongated ball socket joint is actually made up of those 8 bone nuggets, which are the carpal bones as I mentioned. And the radius and ulna bones form the socket half of the joint. My interpretation of this is that in flexion and extension, the wrist acts as a relatively small ball socket joint, and in lateral movement, it's a relatively large ball socket joint. What does seem to be a well-accepted, simple way to look at the wrist's motion is that it appears to have an average range of motion of about 65 degrees laterally and about 150 degrees in flexion and extension. So as I've mentioned before, I want to find a sensible compromise between biomimicry, mechanical efficiency, cost and open source-ness slash DIY-ness. To go back to the other mechanical hands that I've been referring to lately, as far as I've been able to tell, the shadow hand is a simple 2 hinges on top of one another. The in-move hand has flexion, extension and axial rotation, but not really in a way that you could consider biomimetic. The flex hand appears to not have any wrist motion at all currently, but the IRM lab, which developed the flex hand, has a really interesting mechanical joint design in their LIM-S2 Ambidex robot. So the wrist mechanism in that design is a beautifully machined virtual rolling joint, which is designed to emulate the rolling contact of two spheres. This led me to the DLR hand, which is a mechanical hand that I've been aware of for some time, but for whatever reason I've never really looked into it as closely as I ought to have. So the wrist in that design, in the DLR hand, uses a mechanism called a spherical anti-parallelogram mechanism. I wish I could find a bit more information about this mechanism or why they decided to use it, but from what I have been able to work out is that it's really effective for allowing the tendon cables to pass through its centre, one because of the open space and also because of the way it moves, since it minimises the change in distance between the forearm section and the wrist section of the design. Looking at it from the top down, it does look like just a simple crossed over 4x linkage, and it also looks like it can be actuated from the forearm side by driving just two of the joints. It took me a while to wrap my head around this mechanism, and I'm still not sure that I fully understand it, but it does look to be functionally quite similar to the IRM lab wrist joint I mentioned earlier. From the limited footage I've been able to find of the DLR hand, it looks like the wrist mechanism in the actual prototype of that arm might not actually work very well, but that's not necessarily because of the mechanism structure. My first impressions of that mechanism and my brief experimentation with this very quick mechanical mock-up leads me to think that the DLR spherical anti-parallelogram mechanism satisfies the condyloid joint requirements of acting with a wide roll laterally and a small roll in flexion slash extension. I really like the design of it, but I also think that the DLR hand, and particularly its forearm, is much bigger than a human's. In my design, I'm going for a more standard human form factor. So moving forward, I need to make a decision about how far I'm willing to simplify the wrist mechanism. It makes sense to me to at least use a crossed 4x linkage for the lateral motion to allow the cables through, and because it appears to emulate a pretty natural rolling motion like the motion of a real wrist. If I'm going to the trouble of having a 4x linkage in the wrist for the lateral motion, then it wouldn't be too much of a stretch to also add the flexion and extension motion using a very similar looking mechanism to the DLR hands. But since the requirements in my design are going to be a little bit different to that design, it's difficult to say at this stage if that'll be a viable option or not. So armed with this information now, I should be able to start working on an integrated solution which will include both the two axes of motion in the wrist, the palms motion resulting from the CMC joints, and also the saddle joint of the thumb. So as always, a massive thank you to all of my patrons, and I hope to see you all in the next video. Uses a mechanism called a spherical anti-parallelogram mechanism.